Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for joining. We will wait for some time before Movie we can join in and we'll start the session.
Good afternoon, everyone. Pranjal, I think we'll get started and let other people log in slowly. Is that all right?
Yes, sir. Sure.
All right. So a very good afternoon to everyone, and thank you for logging in for this fourth session of PHO trainee academic sessions. And I'm really thankful for the support from everyone, from the faculty and also from the students who have been participating in these sessions the last three, four weeks. They've been really appreciated, and we have seen a lot of enthusiasm from all the participants. Sessions have been really valuable for all of us, and I think we have really taken back some key points and takeaway messages from all these sessions. So today also we are tuned for an exciting session on approach to pancytopenia. I first of all should thank Anand for taking initiative for moderating and mentoring this session. And he has, been successful in getting, I would say one of the best faculties to participate and to contribute on this topic. So we have with us today Dr. Renu Saxena, ma'am. I don't think she needs an introduction to all of us. She was a professor at
Head. Hi.
Hello, ma'am. Welcome. She was professor and head of hematology at Ames, and now she's the director of lab medicine as well as heading the pathology at Medanta, the MedCity in Delhi. We have Durika State Ma'am. She, we all know, she's professor at the Department of Hematology at AIIMS. And we have Dr. Revati Raj Ma'am, who heads the Department of Pediatric Hematology Oncology at Apollo Cancer Hospital in Chennai. Anand Prakash is a professor of Pediatric Hematology Oncology at St. John's Hospital here in Bangalore. And we also have Manasa, who works, who's a fellow at St. John's in Bangalore, and she's going to present today's case. So as usual, we have our two components to this session today. It will be some introduction, didactic, and then followed by case presentation with discussions based on that case. The didactic is on approach to pancytopenia, which Dr. Anna is going to be briefing in the first 10 minutes. And then Dr. Revati Raj Ma'am is going to be talking to us about new advances in bone marrow failure syndromes, followed by the case presentation. So as you know, I've been requesting earlier on also in the previous sessions, please post questions on the chat box and only relevant to the topic today. Also, you know, you can interrupt anytime, ask questions, raise your hand to be participating in the session. So, and also keep your videos on so that we can see each other. Thank you very much, and Anand, over to you to start conduct the session for today. Thank you very much for logging in.
Thanks, Sunil. Let me just share. So on behalf of our division here at the Pediatric Hemonc Unit at St. John's, thanks to the IIPPHO chapter for this opportunity, and a special thanks to all our expert faculty, Dr. Renu Saxena, Dr. Revati Raj, and Dr. Tulika Seth. My fellow Manasa has put in a lot of work today to get our cases ready. For the format, Sunil's mentioned the basic algorithm we'll go over first. Then Dr. Revati Ma'am will tell us some of the exciting updates from the Inherited Marrow Failure Syndrome conference, which was held recently. And we'll go on to the cases. So pancytopenia clearly is a drop in all three blood cell lines. And as hematologists, when we look at a CBC report, it's important to look at, is it one cell line versus multiple cell lines? Because clearly the differential diagnosis varies based on how many cell lines are involved. And this is quite straightforward. Now, if one cell line is low, it's important to look at carefully at the other two cell lines and look where they are. Because we know that many of the evolving pancytopenias could start off with one cell line, and the trend of counts is important. Whether it's quickly recovering in a relatively benign pancytopenia like a post-infectious situation, or whether it's something more worrisome like a severe aplastic anemia or even a malignancy. So one of the important clues, and this comes in even in the definition of a severe aplastic anemia, is to look quickly at the absolute neutrophil count. So anything less than 1,500 we know is a low absolute neutrophil count. And the lower it is, probably more severe the pathology is. And that also points us directly to the marrow. Important to state here that the lymphocyte count itself may be relatively preserved. So just looking at the total count isn't enough. The absolute neutrophil count is probably the way to go ahead. So clearly in a hematology unit, looking at a child with pancytopenia poses an urgent issue because there are potential defects in the marrow, either in the stem cells or in the microenvironment, which could be an infiltrative cause, benign or malignant, but clearly a pancytopenia is something which needs urgent evaluation. It could be increased destruction or decreased production, and the red arrow clearly tells us that this is the larger number and the more sinister cause. The differentials are broad, of course, for pancytopenia, but the common ones we see in children, which I'm sure many of you as trainees would have looked at, is marrow pathology with B12 deficiency, infiltration of benign or malignant diseases, benign being storage diseases, lipid storage, particularly fibrosis in the marrow, malignant being hematolymphoid or solid tumor infiltration of the marrow. Stem cell pathologies we'll talk about in quite a bit of detail today, acquired aplastic anemias and the inherited marrow failure syndromes, Suppression could be viruses, radiation or drugs, immune dysregulation using the purview of pancytopenia with HLH, and the group of peripheral destruction, immune mediated, for example, SLE, classical example, and also importantly evolving the autoimmune lymphoproliferative syndrome, which would be an immune mediated destruction. Sequestration by a large spleen would tell us that yes, there is hypersplenism, and we would have to find out what is the cause of the large spleen. Infections and pancytopenia are, of course, are quite common, and there's a whole gamut of infections, viruses, bacteria, and parasites. And bacteria, we shouldn't forget that tuberculosis, particularly in hematology wards, we would see atypical mycobacterium sometimes in children with immune deficiency, and that clearly can present as pancytopenia besides the usual mycobacterium tuberculosis. Even the recent British guidelines, which talked about evaluation of adult and child with pancytopenia, spoke how important history and clinical examination are. So let's go over some of the important things we need to look at for any child with pancytopenia. The age clearly is important. So younger the child, more likely it is an inherited marrow failure syndrome. But that doesn't mean that these cannot occur in older people. The symptoms usually would be related to the red cell series and to the platelets. So the amount, the duration, and the severity of bleeding and pallor is important. The other clues, of course, fever, bone and joint pain, rash, photosensitivity of SLE are important to give us clues. Drug intake remains one of the important history taking things which we need to do in terms of dose related or idiosyncratic drugs which could cause pancytopenia. The number of needs of transfusions would tell us the duration and the severity of this cytopenia. And I can't stress enough on family history and degrees of consanguinity, not only for the inherited marrow failures, but also in terms of pediatric MDS, so hematological problems in the family, malignancies in the family members are all important to find. In clinical examination, like we saw in history, we would try and get a sense as to how severe the anemia is. Is the fever part of an infection of the neutropenia, or is it part of the disease, like a leukemia or a neuroblastoma? What is the severity of the bleeding? Is there any evidence of lymphoproliferation? So clearly a child with lymphadenopathy and hepatosplenomegaly with pancytopenia would tell us that there's lymphoproliferation and would prompt us to think of malignant causes or even things like ALS. The absence of a liver and spleen is obviously classical for an aplastic anemia. In contrary to that, the presence of a large spleen would tell us that yes, there is some infiltrative process going on. So things like osteopetrosis, myelofibrosis, storage diseases, all that would fit into that group. So knowing whether there is a liver or spleen or the absence of the same is important. Stomatitis, candida, pharyngeal exudates would point towards neutropenia. The classical knuckle pigmentation for B12 is things which we are used to. When we talk about inherited marrow failure syndromes, it's important to remember that sometimes these signs are very subtle and sometimes it's very florid. So all of us as trainees should learn what a typical child with the typical Fanconi's or dyskeratosis looks like. So sometimes short stature when it presents alone might be missed. Failure to thrive is a common feature of many of the inherited marrow failure syndromes. Characteristic facies of Fanconi's would overlap with diamond black fan, with the microcephaly and the triangular facies being similar in both. Dysplastic radii and wasting of thenar remnants specific for Fanconi's. Skeleton anomalies, particularly in Shaman diamond with metaphyseal dysplasia. Sometimes just a few cafe au lait spots. Remember that these could be subtle and making a difference between acquired aplastic anemia and inherited marrow failure syndromes is very, very important. And if it's subtle, picking up these subtle signs is our job before committing the patient to definitive therapy. The classical triad of dyskeratosis of nail dystrophy, leukoplakia, and skin pigmentation is present in every textbook. So what are the major questions after all this? Is the pancytopenia transient or persistent? is there a marrow pathology or is it peripheral destruction? And if there is a marrow pathology, is this congenital or acquired? So the lab evaluation is very important. Obviously, the CBC will tell us the severity, and we talked about the importance of the absolute neutrophil count. The red cell indices are quite helpful. We know that when the marrow is in stress, many times we do get an elevated MCV. And looking at the RDW, if both are elevated, being a nutritional deficiency, and if only MCV is elevated, with a normal RDW being more of a acquired or an inherited marrow failure syndrome, is a useful thumb rule sometimes. Of course, this is just a thumb rule, it's not absolute. Looking at the retic count to differentiate our two broad groups of marrow pathology versus peripheral destruction, and looking at the PS for a macrocytic versus a normocytic anemia, commonly B12 deficiency is not uncommon in our population. The other labs I've listed here are obviously supportive. The ANA, dsDNA, DCT for autoimmune evaluation of tuberculosis, viral panels, B12 levels, and importantly, HB electrophoresis with slightly elevated HbF, telling us that this could be a subtle clue for inherited marrow failure. Of course, often these would be in infancy, so really differentiating whether the little bit of elevation of F is part of physiology or whether it's part of marrow failure can sometimes be challenging. We won't spend too much time on the marrow in terms of the aspirate and biopsy because we have cases and I have better qualified people on my expert panel to talk about this. But some of the classical findings would be a megaloblastic erythroid precursor, pro-erythroblast in parvovirus infection, vacuolated erythroid precursors in Pearson's, features of dysplasia to look for, ring sideroblasts, hemophagocytosis, and blasts. So it's important for a pathology fellow and a pediatric hemonc fellow to become friends and actually look at these marrows carefully. The specific labs would look at MDS and some workup for inherited marrow failures. I'll quickly go ahead because I'm sure Dr. Revati will cover some of these, but I'd just like to say that when we do a marrow for a child with FANC, in the early stages, we may not get the classical drop in cellularity, and only in the later stages, we might get this. And we could spend a little time in the cases in terms of actually differentiating a hypoplastic MDS from an acquired aplastic anemia. Is this possible? How simple it is? What do we need to do? So differentiating an acquired aplastic anemia from an inherited marrow failure syndrome is very important. The spectrum of inherited marrow failures is expanding. We'll hear more about it soon. But just the common important things to keep in mind, germline mutations present at varying ages, spectrum of severity of the cytopenia evolving from one cell line to other cell lines, subtle dysmorphisms, the cancer predisposition, and sometimes organ failure like pulmonary fibrosis and dyskeratosis are important things to keep in mind for inherited marrow failures. So this is an evolving slide in terms of the spectrum of inherited marrow failures to acquired aplastic anemia. And on the left, you would see a high penetrance of Fanconi's and dyskeratosis. And in the middle, DBA, which could be subtle without too many clinical findings. So I'll leave you with this nice table from the Hemonc Clinics of North America, which look at some of the evolving marrow failures. There's a lot of work going on in genetics and new genes which are associated with marrow failures. We'll come back to some of these rarer genes in a little bit of our discussion. So I'll end here and request ma'am to make her presentation.
So thank you, Anand, for setting the stage. You're all able to hear me. So we attended this very interesting update on the International Bone Marrow Failure Syndromes in February, and it was an eye-opener for me. So I just thought it would be a good time to share what we learned from the symposium. Talk on any particular topic, we cannot proceed without saluting the heroes and the pioneers in the field. And the first person is Dr. Kamita, and he's the one who's given us all the criteria. Is this aplastic anemia severe? Is it mild? Is it something we can just observe? Or should we dive in and start treatment immediately? The person on the right, all of you know, is Dr. Fanconi, who first described all the clustering of aplastic anemia cases in the family, and that the fact that it is inherited. And Dr. Neil Young, most of you would know, who taught us all of the pathophysiology and why do people get aplastic anemia. And he is the one who's inspired us to keep asking the question why. And if we are curious, children have this very beautiful system of learning because they keep asking why. And sadly, as we grow older, we stop asking questions and we just want to follow whatever the person ahead of us has done. But we have to keep our curiosity, and that leads us to new paths. So he was the one who did this amazing lecture on, he asked the question, why do we get aplastic anemia? Now we know so much about the pathophysiology of aplastic anemia. These are COVID times, all our morale is low, so I had to add a little bit of Disney magic to the talk. So Disney will keep reappearing during these next 10 minutes, so pardon me. So what we know about aplastic anemia these days is that there are three distinct groups of aplastic anemia. And once we have diagnosed a child with aplastic anemia, we need to put them into these little groups so that we can plan their treatment correctly. We have one chance of treating them. So is it direct marrow injury? Is it an immune mechanism, or is it genetic? Because based on that, we can make our plan of treatment. So the first thing is direct marrow injury. They've been exposed to chemicals, they've been exposed to radiation or a virus which caused marrow suppression. These are direct marrow injury. The treatment for this is going to be completely different, because in this group, if we go and give them immunosuppressive therapy with ATG, obviously it's going to fail. So this group, fortunately, in children is very rare. You see this more in the young adults and in the middle-aged group. But in children, we see this very rarely. So the immune mechanisms of severe aplastic anemia are now the ones that have been most exhaustively studied. And what Dr. Young proposed is, this is a whole spectrum of autoimmunity, not just aplastic anemia. This is the same mechanism involved in ITP, in autoimmune hemolytic anemia, it's in pure red cell aplasia, and which cell line is targeted results in that particular cell line failing. So if it is against the stem cell, then you have aplastic anemia. If it's against platelets, then you have ITP. So the underlying mechanism is all the same. It is an immune dysregulation. So basically something causes an imbalance between the T effector cells and the T regulatory cells. And this results in a lot of cytokine release. And the cytokine release makes more of the cytotoxic T lymphocytes to cause autoimmunity. And there is autoimmune organ destruction. If this is against the hematopoietic stem cells, then that results in severe aplastic anemia. This is an important mechanism for us to know, because in aplastic anemia, the reason why immunosuppressive therapy works is because there is an underlying immune dysregulation. So our ATG targets these dysregulated T lymphocytes. But if we go and give ATG for the direct toxin marrow injury or to the inherited aplastic anemia, then it won't work. Also, it is very important that this whole immune mechanism is highly active only for about a few weeks, maximum 8 to 12 weeks. That's why the results of immunosuppressive therapy are maximum, or the results are best, if we go in and give our immunosuppressive therapy within the first 2.5-3 months from diagnosis. If the patient comes to you late and we give the immunosuppressive therapy, it won't work well, because it's now a burnt out case. If the dysregulated T lymphocytes have already done their job and the marrow is just sitting empty, and our ATG won't work. So also, there is a lot of information coming in about the cytokines involved, which help marrow destruction, hematopoietic stem cells to completely disappear. And the two important ones are interferon gamma and TNF alpha. It's good to know about these mechanisms because these help targeted therapies for the future. So there is also TNF alpha and gamma interferon involved in the whole pathophysiology. The other important discovery is that thrombopoietin is not receptors are present not just on the megakaryocytes, but they also are an important feature of hematopoietic stem cells. So these thrombopoietin receptors are important for hematopoiesis. The stem cells are stimulated through thrombopoietin. So this has been the basis for using L-thrombopag for severe aplastic anemia. So these are the things we've learned about pathophysiology. So as Dr. Anand said, when we've seen a child with acquired aplastic anemia, again, everything is the rule of three. So the first rule of three is it direct toxin? Is it immune dysregulation or is it inherited? So now we've come to the second group, the immune dysregulated acquired aplastic anemia. So the first thing we need to know is it really acquired aplastic anemia? Now, this is a diagnosis of exclusion. So we have to exclude the other two groups, then say, no, this is only acquired. Then as Dr. Anand said, we have to put them into the criteria. So is it severe or very severe or moderately severe? So each of our management will be based on the severity of the disease. And then we have to characterize the aplastic anemia. This is actually a very cool thing that we have learned during the session. And if we characterize, it will help us predict whether our immunosuppressive therapy is going to work or not. And if any child comes to you with a splenomegaly or there's dysplasia in the marrow or there are some blasts, there's marrow fibrosis or there is karyotyping abnormality, this is not aplastic anemia. So we have to think of MDS. So with the aplastic anemia definition, we use the Kamita criteria. I won't go very much into it, but if the retics are low, if the platelets are low, if the ANC is low, then that is severe aplastic anemia. If they don't fit into the criteria, then we call it moderate. Because this is important because whether we have to start treatment immediately or can we wait and watch or should we not give the full treatment or we can just use oral medications. So this is the third component, which was a new learning phenomenon for me. Is this aplastic anemia associated with PNH? Does the child have HLA-DR B115? Was it hepatitis associated aplastic anemia? Or are there features of autoimmunity? This group is important to characterize because they have the best response to immunosuppressive therapy. Because if we say they are placed under this group, we can be a little bit more confident that our immunosuppressive therapy is going to work. So already Dr. Anand has said that we have to do the basic viral studies, bone marrow aspiration, biopsy, and look for the PNH clone, get the cytogenetics and marrow trephine biopsy. Without a marrow trephine biopsy, we cannot label any child as aplastic anemia. And mitomycin C sensitivity forms the backbone of ruling out whether this is an inherited or acquired. They may not have any somatic features of Fanconi. And we need to rule out this aplastic anemia associated with autoimmune disorders, AID. So ANA is the an important component. Always early on, as we are doing the workup, it is important in children to have the HLA typing done in parallel because it will take about 7 to 10 days for all the workup to come back. And in the meanwhile, after we get all the results, one more HLA typing, another 7 to 10 days. Sometimes in the waiting time itself, we may lose these children if they suddenly have septic shock. So all of this workup is done in parallel. There are some optional tests that people are just looking into, looking at the vertebral marrow, MRI on the of the marrow in the vertebra, and they say that if it's uniformly fatty marrow, it's aplastic anemia. If it's patchy, then it's more likely to be MDS. These are all optional tests which we don't recommend doing, but I just thought I'd mention it. And any child with a raised hemoglobin F is a stress marrow, and it may not mean anything, but it's more likely to be inherited. So we have one chance of treating these children because it's an expensive disease. Sometimes people ask, is this cancer, doctor? And you feel maybe for the cancer, we can treat with chemotherapy, and aplastic anemia is difficult because there are not much NGO support, blood transfusion. These days, finding blood donors is difficult, and whether they're going to respond to your treatment or not is an open book. So 3 months down the line, immunosuppressive therapy hasn't worked. You need a transplant. Actually, these are scary conversations to have. So whatever we do, we have to do it well. So that's important, and we need to get it right the first time round. This is a beautiful treatment algorithm. You diagnose a child with aplastic anemia. You look at the HLA typing and you decide, are we going to do immunosuppressive therapy or transplant them? And there are guidelines and rules for making your decisions. So just going through what are the things that help you make the decision. First one is about immunosuppressive therapy. I really like this part where one of the speakers spoke to us about Rumsfeld theory and the things that are known unknowns, the unknown knowns and the known knowns and the unknown knowns. And it's a lot of things that we know about ATG and a lot of things we don't know about ATG. One group says you have to measure levels. Another group said rabbit ATG or horse ATG, which brand? So there's a lot of things. But basically, we need to know that ATG targets the dysregulated T lymphocytes, and we need to get in early before all the dysregulated T lymphocytes are exhausted. That's when it will work. So that is the known known. And it was clear that the horse ATG is superior to rabbit ATG in aplastic anemia. And sorry, it's my cuckoo clock. And this is where Dr. Young did a beautiful talk on clonal evolution. So basically, what are we worried about with aplastic anemia? The stem cells are weak. And we know that once when a teenager is weak, they're more prone to going into drugs and getting drug addicted. So like that, our aplastic anemia stem cells are weak, so they can go in for clonal evolution. And the one thing we learned from his talk is if we use bone marrow stimulating drugs on their own, like thrombopoietin analogs, L-thrombopag, then the risk of clonal evolution is much higher. If we use it in combination with IST, the rates are 4.3%, but as a monotherapy, 16%. So we are never to use L-thrombopag on its own in aplastic anemia setting. And if we use L-thrombopag along with immunosuppressive therapy from day one, the results are much better in children. About 70% of them respond, and the children about 12 years do better than the younger than 12-year-old children. Still, there is about 10% clonal evolution, and we need to start the L-thrombopag on day one. And there is an advantage of using GCSF from day one because it sort of blocks gamma interferon, which is an important mechanism of action of promoting the aplastic anemia. How would I know which child will respond better to immunosuppressive therapy? You can. There are means to measure how many progenitor cells are left behind in the marrow and look at the thrombopoietin levels at diagnosis and after therapy. These are all research things, but basically, if the child has a PNH clone or trisomy 8 on karyotyping or DRB115 and we've got them in early, within 2.5 months, they are more likely to respond better. And this was an interesting paper which says that the thrombopoietin level stays high even after immunosuppressive therapy, and these are the children that do well. So that is a good measure to say if we can assess thrombopoietin levels. A little bit about transplant, this won't be long. So there were some important messages to take here. This is survival, not just event-free survival. You can see that there is a big difference between transplant and event-free survival in immunosuppressive therapy. As at 3 years, they look very nice, close together. But as time goes on, with time, 10 years, 15 years. We're talking about children. So we want to give them event-free survival. And certainly, transplant has an advantage over immunosuppressive therapy because a lot of them go into clonal evolution. So long-term, transplant is superior. And Dr. Dufour did a talk on the EBMT data analysis. And he said at three years, transplant and immunosuppressive therapy both look good, 91%, 87%. But if they looked longer and longer, the event-free survival for IST dropped down to 33%. So if you have a chance to transplant children, that would be the first choice. When we are transplanting, marrow is superior to PBSC because we were talking about all these thrombopoietin and mesenchymal stem cells, all the macro environment that is required to stimulate hematopoiesis are there if we use bone marrow. So bone marrow has an advantage over PBSC. And more people are going into alternate donor. So if you have a matched unrelated donor, or a haploidentical donor, the results are as good as matched sibling. This is in Western data. We are yet to prove it in our country. So that is where the rest of the world is moving away from IST as compared to transplant. So this is the era of gene whole exome sequencing. So there's a lot of information we get, but it's very complex. The information we get, we need to understand how to process it, how to help the families that we deal with. So we get a report. Is this significant, not significant? How are we going to counsel them? So when would you do the whole genome sequencing? Whole exome sequencing, sorry, WES. If you find that there is any dysmorphism, yes, you have to look at the pancreas, you have to look at the lung, ask for a good history whether there is kidney, liver, or lung problems in the family. And this is standard that if there is a family history of any blood disorder, neoplasms, liver or lung problems. Liver and lung problems point to DKC. So if there's someone with cirrhosis, someone who had emphysema is what people think they have, think that it could be a family with DKC. If there's consanguinity, small community with a lot of consanguinity, if the child has presented less than two, or they have any somatic features. And obviously at the end of 3 months, they haven't responded to IST. We have to look to see if this is genetic. And Dr. Neelam Giri did an overview of the germline mutations and said that each of them have given us insight into hematopoiesis, Fanconi, DKC, learning about each of them and how hematopoiesis also has given us a lot of insight into the world of cancer. What causes cancer at an individual cell level, because these disorders control cell cycle. And there was a beautiful talk on inherited marrow failure syndromes where there is the classic presentation and the non-classic presentation. This is what Dr. Anand was alluding to in his talk. Classic presentation, you know there's something wrong with them. They look small, they have dysmorphic features, there's early head and neck malignancy, there's family history. So that is actually easy to diagnose. And there are a lot of Fanconi genes that have been identified, and all of them are autosomal recessive except FANCB, which is X-linked recessive. And Fanconi respond to androgens. The new thing in Fanconi is to use antioxidants like quercetin, and this delay the onset of aplasia. And we can provide supportive care. There's also exciting gene therapy in Fanconi. And we have to do surveillance for head and neck malignancies, which are associated with human papilloma virus. And we can use the vaccine to prevent head and neck malignancies in Fanconi. And if the chromosome fragility test is negative, but you think this could be Fanconi, you can do the chromosome fragility on skin fibroblasts. Dr. Babu Rao presented FA data from India. It was a very good talk. And we have a lot of FANCL in India, which is rare in Western centers. So that's what we found out. And FA is a fast-forward disorder. So there is inflammation, dysfunction of mitochondria, epigenetics altered, DNA damage. So we go from birth to death in the cell cycle very, very fast. And the registry for Fanconi anemia also exists in India. And most of the children have presented with somatic malformations. The new thing in the world of DKC is by flow cytometry, we can look at telomere length. If you look at the three charts here shown, the lady in the middle, female 55, has very short telomere length. And this is the hallmark of dyskeratosis congenita. And they have cirrhosis, lung fibrosis, and overall their cancer risk is high and they have lung complications. So the only thing, if you have DKC, they respond better to danazole. The new non-classical aplastic anemias are the ones to watch out for. They mentioned GATA2, who present quite a lot with malignancies or with hematological malignancies, or ADA2, which is an immune deficiency autoinflammatory disorder. So these are the children that present suddenly with optic neuritis and neurological manifestations and marrow failure syndromes with immune deficiency and MECOM, where actually you need to give them full conditioning rather than low dose conditioning if you're transplanting them. So these are the non-classical aplastic anemia, and we need to know more about them. So DKC and FA long-term follow-up, even after transplant, the outcomes are not very good. They get malignancies. So the spectrum of marrow failure goes what we thought about the direct toxin, immune phenomenon, and inherited are all one spectrum, and they are Venn diagrams which intersect with each other. Anand also had put it up in his talk. So we are learning more about how they interact with each other. I can't end my talk without paying my respects to Dr. Pushpa. She was the professor of pediatric hematology in the Children's Hospital where I first trained in Chennai, and she passed away yesterday, and she went peacefully at home. And these are the teachers that help tell us that if we have the courage to pursue our dreams, all our dreams will come true. So I hope you benefited something from this last few minutes, and good luck to all of the young fellows here, and hope you are able to do more than whatever we've done in these fields for our country and our children. Over to you, Anand.
Yeah, thank you so much, ma'am. That was great. It set the stage very nicely. And I think now we would request all our fellows who are participating to start taking part and putting their questions in the chat box. We have a couple of cases prepared by my fellow Dr. Manasa. I'll hand over to her for her presentation.
Anand, just before we proceed, you know, because our next case is going to be on workup, there are a few questions which are asked on the chat box. Most of them have been responded to. There are two for you, Dr. Revati ma'am. I think one was that data on IST plus eltropag versus IST plus romiplast was one question. The second question was
enough that data on romiplast, but it's only now the adult trials are in place, so we don't know enough to use it in children.
The second question was on, that was in fact not, it's on the chat box, was sent to me, that was the telomere length assessments, although we know that flow cytometry I think no one is doing in India, but is there a way out, for example, doing the, you know, clinical exomes or whole genome sequencing, can we come to know on telomere length on those for DKC? That was a particularly for DKC.
So Dr. Beju George has set up the telomere length lab, and anyone who's interested, you can speak to him, and I think he will appreciate anyone joining on his project. Yeah, I mean, it is an important test for our country especially, and sometimes when we've transplanted aplastic anemia twins, I always worry whether the other twin will have the similar problem, and we've used the stem cells. So it's important for us to look at telomere length, and that is certainly a deficiency in our country.
The other question is, which was I think posted again now, that was in which type of aplastic anemia immunosuppressive drug could be offered upfront, like when ANC is 1,000 to 1,500 or ANC is 500 to 1,000. So I really don't understand it fully, but that's what it is. So if you could understand the question,
if
then
you
can respond.
If your neutrophil count is above 1,000, and we wouldn't even call them aplastic anemia. So if they come under the category where they have PNH clone or they have other autoimmunity, their hepatitis related. So in these, without hesitation, and they don't have a matched family donor, then we would offer IST upfront. Yeah.
I have a question, ma'am. You know, one of the slides which you showed on transplant and aplastic anemia, and the slide was basically on bone marrow being a better stem cell source. There was a point mentioned on TPO agonists in that slide. So I couldn't really understand what was the context of that. So if you just really
what they said was, when you're using marrow, all the things that you need from the marrow, which helps the stem cell to grow, your GCSF, the thrombopoietin, everything that's there in the microenvironment gets transplanted along with the stem cells. So that's probably why it works better than peripheral blood stem cells, which have literally been yanked out of the marrow, come into the peripheral blood, and we are separating them and infuse them, which is non-physiological. So in aplastic anemia, there is also a theory that the marrow microenvironment is not so healthy. So if you replace it with all the microenvironment, that's why the results are better.
I think Dr. Tulika wants to ask a question before we proceed with the case. Ma'am, you have raised your hand, I think.
So difficult.
Sorry, I'm not very technically advanced. So excellent talks, both of them fantastic. And I think the students would have definitely benefited from that. So I just wanted to answer some of the questions that were coming along. So the ASH 2019 has a study that is published in pediatric patients of aplastic anemia, and they've said less than 12 years, there is no benefit to adding L-thrombopag. So that I think is really important, because the cost of L-thrombopag is very significant. And if it doesn't add anything to the ATG and cyclosporin, then possibly for younger children, that is less than 12 years, there's no additional benefit to doing that. So I think that is one of the questions that had come up. The other thing, I just wanted to talk about the CalMatter criteria, and Dr. Renu is with us, so she'll comment even more. And this is very important, because this is actually, it was designed for adults. And the important thing is that you need two out of the three criteria, definitely. What is there is that if you have severe aplastic anemia, in which your ANC is less than 500, this is an emergency, because in 1 year, if these patients don't respond to treatment, more than 70% of these patients will be dead. Now, if they have very severe aplastic anemia, that is the ANC is less than 200, this is a huge emergency. And these patients should be admitted immediately, because many of them will not be there in the next couple of months. If they are non-severe aplastic, that is the ANC is above 500, these patients respond really well to whatever you give them and they'll survive. So severe and very severe aplastic anemia, in which the ANC is less than 500 or less than 200, is an absolute emergency. And just a little comment on Anand's wonderful talk. One of the things that I like my students to do is, once you've made your lists for pancytopenia, I often tell them, when the patient comes, you know, you're not going to be able to do all the workup, even though the history and everything will give you clues. So I tell them to also make a list of patients with pancytopenia and organomegaly, pancytopenia without organomegaly. So with that and some very basic labs, you can come up with some really good differentials, and that will guide your workup, because especially if it's a child, you can't take so much blood. And when we come to the ATG response, I'll comment then, but excellent talks, you've really set the stage. Thank you.
Anand, over to you. I think you can start with the case now. Thank you.
Thank you for those questions and comments. We'll just try and share our screen for the case discussion. Just give me a moment.
While you're loading, Anand, I'll take one more question. So the question is, I think Dr. Kulika or Revati ma'am, whosoever wants to take this, is that if your mitomycin C stress hydrogens is negative and you have no phenotypic features, you still need to do NGS is the question which has been posted.
So we'll go back to answering this question. If the child is less than 2 years old, if there's a family history of a hematological malignancy or aplastic anemia, or there's someone in the family who's had cirrhosis or had lung problems, or if there is infant deaths, consanguinity, they come from an area where people marry within the family, it is better to go for the molecular mutation. Only in 50% of these children we'll find a mutation, but the whole algorithm of how you treat them will change based on the mutation analysis. So if there is a strong feeling that this is not straightforward aplastic anemia, it is better to get the sequencing done. Sometimes it can be just a subtle dysmorphism, just a flat ball of thumb, no? There's no ball of thumb. So, or just one cafe au lait spot. If you see these and the mitomycin C is negative, and if your gut feeling, or they're shorter, they're a little darker than their parents. So all of these, it is better to get the sequencing done. The point about use of L-thrombopag, Dr. Young did say that the NIH study was small for children and they didn't have the numbers as much as the adults. So what they found was that the over 12-year-olds clearly benefited. In the under 12-year-old, their results were already 70%. So it didn't increase from 70%. But with IST alone in our country, we are not seeing 70%. So if you add the L-thrombopag early with IST, maybe we could bring it up to 70% that we are seeing in the West. This is my own personal feeling.
Another will share your screen?
Yeah. So I'll hand over to my fellow Dr. Manasa to take the cases forward, and many of these questions will probably pop up again and we can go to some depth in discussion of the workup. We'll focus on the workup. We'll probably take treatment and other treatment related details at a later session. Over to Manasa.
Good afternoon, everyone. Today I'll be presenting two cases. First case is a 9.5-year-old male child. His second born of non-consanguineous parents is developmentally normal and was a previously well child. He presented with history of spontaneous ekymotic patches all over the body and gum bleeds for 1 month. There was no history of any fever or other bleeding manifestations. In past history, we have jaundice so 1 month prior to presentation, for which he received some ayurvedic medications. Details were not available, and there was no history of any easy bruisability or blood transfusions in the past. There was no history of any drug intake prior to that. And family history, there was no significant family history in terms of blood cancer or any blood-related disorders requiring frequent transfusions in the near family members. And there was no history of any congenital anomalies in the family. And treatment history, he was admitted outside and received 2 units of PRBC and 4 units of platelets in view of severe anemia and low platelets. On examination, he was hemodynamically stable. There was pallor and ekymotic patches present all over the body. There was no gross dysmorphism on examination, and systemic examination was within normal limit. On evaluation in September, when he presented, he had pancytopenia with the peripheral smear cell normocytic normochromic anemia with lymphocytosis and marked thrombocytopenia. And the AMC was around 577. And prior to admission, he had another count done outside, which also showed pancytopenia. In the other investigations, the LFT and RFT was normal, PT-APTT was normal, and the bone marrow aspiration, it showed the imprint smear. It was hypocellular and there was chiefly lymphocytes. There was no maturation arrest and the impression was hypocellular marrow with increased iron stores. And the bone marrow biopsy, it was hypocellular with apparent increase in lymphocytes and plasma cells with few mast cells and eosinophils. The impression, it favored aplastic anemia. This was the marrow of the child in
This is probably a classical presentation of a young child presenting with hepatitis and then evolving to a severe pancytopenia with marrow aspirate and biopsy being pretty suggestive. So could I request Dr. Renu Saxena, ma'am, she's been waiting very patiently for all the to talk out their definitions and clinical features. So ma'am, ultimately the ball is in your court. Please could you teach us a little bit about peripheral smear evaluation? Of children who had aspirates at centers done outside, how much should we rely on that? We learned that biopsy is important, so a little bit of light on that.
So the first thing is peripheral smear examination. And what we should look at the peripheral smear is also look at the red cell morphology along with the various counts that we make a general assessment of. And it's important to know if we see if we see macro ovalocytes and if we see things like that or a lot of polychromasia, we could then suspect some other causes underlying pancytopenia. For example, if we see macro ovalocytes, hypersegmented neutrophils, you would want to keep megaloblastic in mind. If you see a lot of polychromasia and hyperleukocytosis, not too much of hypersegmented, you would at least at the back of your mind want to exclude a PNH along with aplastic or a PNH by itself. Apart from that, what you see in a peripheral smear is what we term as pancytopenia with relative lymphocytosis, which means it's not lymphocytosis, absolute lymphocytosis, but it's just a relative term that in view of the low TLC, lymphocytes appear to be more prominent. So the term that we use is pancytopenia with relative lymphocytosis. Coming to aspirate, you very rightly said we very often get aspirates from different private setups and they are labeled as aplastic anemia. Aspirate is not really a good indicator of the actual cellularity of the bone marrow. However, it can give you a clue sometime, but you may not, if it's a diluted marrow, you will also again get very few cells and should not be used if in an aspirate you get a large number of fat-rich fragments with very few trails showing lymphocytes. You can suspect, but you should never diagnose aplastic anemia on an aspirate. Therefore, you have to resort to biopsy. Plus, you have to be also careful when you look at the biopsy, because when you look at the subperiosteal regions in a bone biopsy, they are normally very less cellular. And therefore, you should have a good sized bone biopsy to look at. Very often, we have also seen a relatively superficial bone biopsy mislabeled as aplastic anemia because the subperiosteal relatively less cellular marrow was taken to be truly hypoplastic. And therefore, a good size of biopsy going deep down is what you need to evaluate to have a correct assessment of bone biopsy cellularity. So I was coming to what is the other thing you have to keep in mind when you look at the biopsy. So very often we get a piece, it's a big size biopsy, but when you look at the microscope, under the microscope, you find it is mainly cartilage or fibrofatty tissue with very small marrow tissue. So apart from size of the so-called tissue which is sent, it is important to have a good number of intertrabecular spaces. So an adequate bone biopsy should have between 6 to 10 intertrabecular spaces. As far as possible, it should go deep down so that one can actually assess cellularity of the bone marrow.
Okay.
Anand, Dr. Jagdish Chandra, sir has raised hands. So I think he wants to...
Sure. Please go ahead.
Yeah.
Yes.
Actually, my comment is on... I'm audible?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, question to Dr. Saxena is that when we are getting the reports of the bone marrow biopsy for generally we do not get that percentage of that is described in the textbooks. What percentage cellularity is there? Yes. And if the cellularity is, say, moderately reduced, say between 25 to 50, what is the hematopoietic cell percentage? So that is what is the kind of importance of that? And number two, for a patient of aplastic anemia, generally we read that the marrow should also describe the absence of the hemophagocytosis, absence of megaloblastic changes, and absence of myelofibrosis. So that will truly describe that this we are dealing with just a hypoblastic marrow, primarily hypoblastic marrow.
Yes.
And of course, this myelofibrosis also. Yeah.
Yes, very true. So coming to your first question, it is absolutely important to give the percentage of cellularity. And there are some issues that come into this. So often we get biopsies which are patchily cellular, which means you have large hypoplastic areas with intervening cellular areas. And it can actually become very difficult to give an actual cellularity. So one of the ways which we find useful to do is, ideal of course is if you have, if you can have some kind of a scale and you can do an actual count. But in the absence of that, if you'll take space by space and do a rough estimate of cellularity in each space and then take out an average from that, you're likely to get a reasonably adequate information on cellularity. You're absolutely right. We must give a percentage cellularity in each of the biopsy reports that are there. In addition, we have to look at some other features in biopsy, which should also be mentioned. Very rightly said, whether there is evidence of fibrosis, because that will help it differentiate from some of the other things in an adult or an older child, even in MDS. We should look at whether there are any blasts seen, whether there are groups of blast scenes. Again, it will help us differentiate from a myelodysplastic syndrome in an older child, especially if you get those. And we should also look at other things in the biopsy. For example, are we seeing any other group of cells, any abnormal cells which may be present over there? But cellularity is absolutely a must and has to be given. It is even advisable. Sometimes you can write patchily cellular marrow showing an overall cellularity of so much percent. One other point which I would like to say is very often or sometimes our clinicians feel it is a hypoplastic, but you get a normal cellular biopsy. What do you do? Where could things have gone wrong? And this happens quite often. So two things. One is that aplasia, when it starts, can be patchy. And if you do a biopsy from another site, then you may be able to pick up hypoplasia. The other thing is, sometimes in inherited bone marrow failure syndromes, you may have normal bone marrow cellularity, and yet they may be having a inherited bone marrow failure syndrome when you have to resort to the other high-end tests that are there. I hope that answers your questions.
Yes, ma'am, that was great. That really clarifies the important things which a PHO fellow should probably go down and speak to the lab colleagues to actually look at aspirates and biopsies and pick up the keywords you spoke about. Infiltration, fibrosis, yeah. Any features of dysplasia. Yeah. I just had one thought here. We always talk about that 1-2% of aplastic anemias which would evolve into ALL, and that sometimes you may get some small clusters of blasts in the biopsy and probably not so much in the peripheral blood. I would just put it to all the experts to just share their thoughts on this. How this is not common, yes. But is this something we need to keep a watch out for?
Yes, we have seen, and this was very interesting because we earlier used to believe if you get blasts in an aplastic marrow, they should be acute myeloid leukemia only. But you are right; we have sometimes come across ALLs presenting into an aplastic marrow with few clusters of blasts. And that's why evaluation of a bone marrow biopsy has to be very meticulous, and you have to look out for blasts. It's even sometimes good to resort to immunohistochemistry if you can see some, because on a biopsy, sometimes it can be very difficult to differentiate a megaloblast from a blast. They both have large nuclei, they both have scant cytoplasm. So you look at the surrounding cells, which gives you a reasonably good idea. If you see the large cells surrounded by normoblastic erythroid cells, you would think it's most likely a megaloblast. But you could always resort to IHC, CD71 for erythroid cells, and if you look at other CD34, CD19 or other things for the rest of the blast. Yes, you can have ALLs in an I have seen ALLs in aplastic marrows as well.
Sure. Yeah, we have to be very careful in our country because sometimes they present with pancytopenia and the local hospital, yes, just to stabilize the child, they could be ALL, but they give the transfusion with one dose of steroids. So by the time they come to us and we do the marrow, all the, yes, blasts are gone and we may miss, especially if it's patchy. So we have to be absolutely sure that based on the history and the clinical findings. So if we find any little organomegaly, it may just be a small spleen or a hepatomegaly. So clinical examination and putting the whole story together with a careful bone marrow biopsy assessment is important before we label the child as being aplastic anemia or ALL. Sometimes it's okay to say, I want to follow up in a few days' time rather than jump in and start any treatment. Yeah.
Thank you. If we could move on to the next question, Dr. Renu, ma'am.
Yes.
We are always, we look to the pathology colleagues to try and sort out the etiology of aplasia. Would the aspirate and the biopsy really help us, or is that just a morphological assessment of what's happening and we need to fall back on other labs for etiology?
So in most cases, it's not really possible to find out the etiology, but you can sometimes have clues. For example, sometimes parvovirus infection can also lead to aplastic anemia apart from PRCA, which we very commonly see. And typically in a parvovirus infection, you get large erythroid cells, query megaloblastoid, having large intranuclear inclusions, and which give you a clue that this could be an underlying etiology for the aplastic. Apart from that, there are very few other etiologies which you can really make out for aplastic anemia. So we have to resort to other things.
Sure. Thank you, ma'am. We'll go ahead with what we did for this child and we'll get the clinicians in to help us out.
Further workup in the child, CMV IgM showed it was negative. Flow for PNH was done, it was negative, and the stress cytogenetics for family was done, which was also negative.
So, ma'am, I'll put it to Dr. Tulika, ma'am, who very rightly said that when we train our trainees, they should have an approach in terms of what labs they want to send. So, here for some reason, our team decided only to send a CMV IgM. But the textbook talks about a whole viral panel. What all should we test for and why, and does it really matter? Because ultimately when we have a severe aplastic anemia, the therapy probably doesn't change. So could you throw some light on that?
So I think that's a good point. But when you have a patient who presents with hepatitis, especially in our country, because almost all viruses like hepatitis A, B, C have all been reported, as well as the seronegative hepatitis. And then there are, like ma'am had said, parvovirus, but even CMV, EBV can present. So I think at least a hepatitis B and C should also be done, because the therapy for that, along with the treatment of the aplastic, would be to treat the hepatitis B or C. So that would be my point of view. And incidence of hepatitis causing aplastic anemia is, at least at our center, it's about 10 to 15%. So it's not uncommon.
But does that change anything in the way we follow up the patient?
So the only thing would be, obviously, if it's due to EBV or parvo, you wouldn't necessarily do any additional treatment. But if it is due to hepatitis B or C, then the treatment would also be there for that. So that's why it's important to make sure that you test for, in, so you've already done CMV, which is very important because if CMV would be positive, you would treat for that. Now there are, we've even had cases where the implicating virus was dengue. Of course, in those cases, they would not present with hepatitis. Many of these viruses can be transient. The virus may go away and you may be left with the sequelae of the viral attack, which is the aplastic anemia. And if it's a virus which doesn't require any treatment, then that's fine.
Sure, sure. So on the same note, Dr. Tulika, ma'am, this PMH workup, getting a small clone versus a relatively larger clone, we do sometimes see that, of course, in this case, we didn't see a PNH clone. How does that help us? How much weightage would you give to that?
So actually, a small PNH clone will be there in most patients who have acquired aplastic anemia. And it's sometimes quite useful in the sense that if you have that, then it's less likely to be an inherited bone marrow failure syndrome. So that is one utility of it. Second, having a small PNH clone, these patients are going to have a chance of responding to ATG therapy. So that again gives you some support. Having a large PNH clone in a young patient would be unusual. Usually PNH would happen in more 13, 14 year old or older patients. But having a large PNH clone has implications because these patients may have hemolysis, they may end up with renal failure and other things. So it's important to know if your patient has a large PNH clone and manage the PNH component of it. But a small PNH clone will be there in many patients, and we see that in patients post ATG as well. They may develop a PNH clone, and usually if it's a small clone, there is no separate implication of it.
Also to remember that the children who've come after transfusion to do the PNH clone assay on the neutrophils rather than on the red cells, because sometimes that may mislead us. Yeah.
I think we do it on the neutrophils and brand new site series. Yeah.
Monocytes and neutrophils.
Yeah, not all labs, so just for people to know, that's all.
Good.
There's a question which has been sent, that is, what is, you know, how do you define small and large? So I think, you know, Dr. Tulika, Dr. Reno, you probably can take
it. Yeah. So, you know, the cutoffs that we use primarily are 1%. More than 1% PNH clone is positive, and between 0.1 to 1% of PNH clone is mainly for scientific interest, which is there. So above 1%, if you have from 1% to about 10 to 15% is a small clone. That's what we usually get, like small clone. We've seen, however, patients who have a clone of almost 50%, 60%, 80% as well, which is what we term as large clone of PNH. We've even seen, they are even more prone to thrombosis. But as Tulika very, very rightly said, in very young children, you don't get such large clones.
But I think Dr. Tulika's ma'am's point of evolution post-ATG to developing larger clones of PNH is important, because I remember a child years ago where we had given ATG and then later the child came in with a Bakshiarian. True enough, a small, relatively small PNH clone had become larger. So important things to follow up when we treat with ATG.
I think that's very important for counseling for the family. And the other question is how long to wait. So now hepatitis and post-hepatitis aplastic anemia patients, it's important to treat them early. And usually they can develop hepatitis, the aplastic anemia, within 1 to 3 months. If the patient's already had 1 or 2 months of the aplastic anemia, please don't wait, because this, as Dr. Revati had said earlier, the better chance of response is going to be earlier. So if you've, waiting for 6 months or more, you know, that's really not to be done.
Sure. So that point is a very important take-home message for all of us in terms of the severity of the aplastic anemia and the rapidity with which we need to evaluate. So this child, go.
Stress cytogenetics for family was done, which was negative, and the bone marrow cytogenetics was normal.
So at this point, we need the help of Dr. Reno Saxena, ma'am, again, in terms of
yes,
the karyotyping the RCCs in children versus aplastic anemia. It's a difficult situation with refractory cytopenias of childhood. Could you guide us in terms of the workup there?
So it is in young children, as it was said, and actually they say even bone marrow failure syndromes can even be seen in as old people as 30, 40 years also. So you can do stress cytogenetics with mitomycin. That is what we do. And that is a reasonably sensitive way to pick it up, especially Fanconi's. But it's not 100%. It has its own limitations. And therefore, you do it in the two concentrations. You do 100 microgram per liter and 50 microgram per liter, as you saw in the report that was there also. We actually do it in three, but you can do it in two. And if you find that in 100 microgram, you get more than two breakages, that is what we take as positive. Coming to karyotype, when patchy cellular bone marrow biopsy, even though overall cellularity is less than 25%, and you are getting this erythropoiesis, or you are getting this myelopoiesis, or you are getting this megakaryopoiesis in the form of micromegakaryocytes, then you would want to exclude MDS with aplastic anemia. And if that be so, for that, you have to resort to karyotyping. Especially you would be looking for monosomy 7, trisomy 8. Those are the things that you look out for. These are karyotypic changes associated with myelodysplastic syndrome. So those are the things that we must, then only one should ask for a complete MDS workup, karyotyping, FISH, or if need be, NGS. But otherwise, you wouldn't. If you don't see any cells, you just see lymphoid cells, no other myeloid precursors or erythroid precursors, I don't think one needs to go in for MDS karyotyping.
Sure. And often now we face this challenge of recently a transfusion having been given and our lab having concerns about running the chromosome breakage test. Is this something which other centers are also facing? Is there a time duration between the recent transfusion and the chromosome breakage test in terms of an accurate report?
Yes. So RBCs are supposed to have an effect even on the chromosomal breakages, depending on what kind of oxidative stress they are in. So normally in Fanconi's, the stress is such that you get a large number of breakages. But if the patient is transfused, the normal RBCs counteract that effect, and they can to some extent reduce the chromosomal breakages that would be there. Ideally, therefore, one should do the stress cytogenetics about 1 week after transfusion has been given.
Okay, sure. I think there was this discussion about the telomere length.
Yes.
Talk about and the telomere length. So could I have all the experts on this? We did have a little bit of discussion as we were loading the slides.
Telomeropathies, as they are called, are now coming up in a big way. And as was said by Dr. Rifti, it's not readily available as yet. It's available as a research tool. And I think CMC Velour is standardized as of now. We need to move on to this in future. You can also add H-TERT gene to it, because that gives more information than a telomere length itself.
Sure. Right. So very nicely said. So we do TERC and TERT mutations, and we are doing the telomere length by RT-PCR. It's been set up at ICGB lab in Delhi, which is a government center. It's an ICMR center, and they are doing it again as a research a tool at the moment.
Okay, that's great, because that's something which we often miss in terms of our workup, and we wonder whether there are some things which, as besides the clinical clues, of course, which could help us. So we go ahead in terms of this child. This child unfortunately didn't have any sibling HLA match, and so I'll get Manasa to take us through the course of this child.
The child was lost to follow and presented back in December 2019. Then, in the meanwhile, the child had got single agent cyclosporine from an outside hospital. And at presentation in December, we had seen some improvement in his ANC count. And ANC count, the previous count was like 270 when the last count with us. And post cyclosporine, this ANC count has come to had come to 900. And the child was their parents were counseled for immunosuppressive therapy, which was given in the form of ATG followed by cyclosporine in February. And then in the L-thrombopag was added on, and then following the immunosuppressive therapy, the child had good response and in terms of increased ANC count and improving platelet count and decrease in the number of transfusions of PRBC and platelet required.
So in this child, of course, the discussion was interesting because we did managed to raise some funds and actually managed to give the L-thrombopag. Let's hope the L-thrombopag actually works, though he is less than 12 years of age. So I'll put this to Dr. Kavika, as we discussed when preparing for this session, we have only one chance in India to treat aplastic usually. So are there any other predictors which you would look at prior to committing a challenge?
Right, so Dr. Revathi had nicely described some of the more complicated predictors like intracellular gamma interferon. What we use are very simple. We use the absolute lymphocyte count, if that's more than 1,000, and the absolute reticulocyte count more than 25. So if these are more than 1,000, more than 25, that's a really good predictor. The other predictor actually is after you give the ATG. So 1 week later, if your absolute lymphocyte count drops to more than 50, by more than 50,000, then again, your patient is very likely to respond to the ATG. So you can predict before and you can predict immediately after, because if the patient is not going to respond, then you have to start, in our country, you have to start preparing the funds and preparing things from, and that takes a lot of time. So these are the simple predictors that we have. The other predictors, unfortunately, are not always available to us. And so we prefer these simple tests.
Yeah, that's very helpful.
I think following up retic count is a good predictor. So on every once in 2 weeks after giving the ATG, if there is a serial increase in reticulocyte count, then you know that there is steady response. So at least by 8 to 12 weeks, you'll have an idea where you are.
Yeah. And the transfusion rate will go down well. Yep.
Sure, sure. And could I put it to Dr. Revathi, ma'am, you please briefly take us through the algorithm of treatment, but knowing that more options are available in terms of donor options, what do you think should be the algorithm for our country?
I think there was also a question in the chat, and I feel this has to be individualized. It depends on the family, it depends on the center, and it has to be individualized. So if you have a patient like yours, post hepatitis A, aplastic anemia, no donor in the family, then it's a no-brainer. You would offer ATG for them because you know they're going to respond well to the ATG. So if they have a PNH clone, they're post hepatitis A, they are associated with other autoimmunity. So these are the children, and or they have HLA 15. So these children or trisomy 8, they will respond. So the other group, say there is a child who's come with a huge pneumonia, and these are not people, they're very sick and they're heading for the ventilator. This is not a person that's going to tolerate ATG. So you would stabilize them. And if there is, even if it means they have a matched unrelated donor or a haploidentical donor, upfront you would offer that, because you can't really make these children wait for 3 months for the neutrophils to recover. So it has to be individualized and given. But the whether to do ATG or transplant for genetic disorders, definitely it's transplant. So if you're talking about any inherited marrow failure syndromes, any child who has a fully matched sibling, transplant over ATG. The other group where they don't have a matched family donor, the ones that you have initial group where you think they will have a good response to ATG, use that. But if they've come in very sick, they have a consolidation, they have repeated infections or platelet refractoriness, and you don't think they're going to last the 8 to 12 weeks after the ATG. Because remember, to give ATG also, you need platelets above 50,000. So these are the children for whom you would opt for alternate donor transplant. Obviously, discussing the risk with such families and use granulocytes to bridge the gap to the transplant. And if we've used immunosuppressive therapy, there's more and more data to say don't stop the immunosuppressive therapy at 6 months, give a prolonged course, make it 1 year, even 18 months. So the ones for whom we've continued 18 months do better, because most of the relapses happen when we just try to taper the immunosuppression in a, even it may just be a slight taper. So we have to be careful and give a prolonged immunosuppressive course rather than be in a hurry to withdraw it.
Dr. Jagdish Chandra, I think, raised a hand.
Yeah, Dr.
Jagdish,
sir, could you please?
Yeah, I have this question on,
I have this question.
On the management that this child has received. I think what the previous slide had shown that this child was given eltrombopag, and I was just wanting to know whether it was already planned that at this stage we'll start eltrombopag, because if you look at the counts, the child is already showing some improvement with the ATG cyclosporin. So what was the reason for giving eltrombopag in this side here? Because it shows ANC pretty good, and even platelets of 15,000 is all right, and HB of 9.3, maybe it is supported by transfusion, but then I was just wondering what is the reason for starting eltrombopag.
So here the eltrombopag was just based on the original data, which is relatively encouraging, and the fact that this child didn't have any match sibling donor. But your point is very well taken, that even with only cyclosporin, this child had already moved and improved his neutrophil count. So you're right that probably this was a child who could have managed with only ATG infection. Point well taken. So, are there any questions at this stage, or we'll quickly go on to the other case? And cognizant of the time that we just have a few minutes more, but maybe we'll quickly run through to just contrast the two cases, and we can have a few questions.
So, our second case is a 4-month-old female child, first born of non-consanguineous marriage. The child was developmentally normal, and there was no significant antenatal or birth history, and no significant family history. The child presented with history of fever for 3 days, loose stools for 2 days. The fever was low grade and subsiding with medications. There was no history of increased oral intake, fast breathing, rashes, or any associated symptoms. Child was exclusively breastfed and completely immunized. On examination, the child had significant failure to thrive with the sparing of the head circumference, and there was severe pallor and hyperpigmentation of dorsum of hands and feet without any gross dysmorphic features. On the systemic examination revealed a soft hepatomegaly of 2 cm, and there was no splenomegaly. On evaluation, the child showed pancytopenia with low retic count, and peripheral smear showed normocytic normochromic with relative lymphocytosis and thrombocytopenia. The bone marrow smear was hypocellular with maturation arrest of myeloid cells, increase in lymphocytes with evidence of hemophagocytosis, and decreased megakaryocytes. The other investigation, the child had come with fever and thrombocytopenia. The child had dengue, NS1, which was positive. LFT and RFT was normal. Vitamin B12 was done, which was low, and with the mother's B12 being low, and HIV was negative. So this was a marrow smears. These are the marrow smears of the child. The marrow report, it showed hypocellular marrow with maturation arrest and some evidence of hemophagocytosis.
So this is in contrast to 4-month-old who has some hyperpigmentation, comes in with acute febrile illness with this low B12. So in fact, this child was in the general pediatric unit before coming to us. So Could I request Renu Saxena, ma'am, how do we interpret this low B12? The marrow doesn't really fit into that. And have you seen this pattern of hemophagocytosis? Because it was a little confusing in terms of what's actually troubling this baby. There are some reports of early inherited marrow failures which may have hemophagocytosis. Any comments?
Yeah. So, firstly, addressing the low B12 levels which are there in baby and mother. You know, it could also be low because it could have happened because the patient had so much of diarrhea as part of the symptomatology. But I don't rely too much on low B12 levels alone because a lot of times free B12 is what we are measuring. But B12 is bound to B12 binders, transcobalamins, which go up in infections and can lead to increased binding of B12, leading to falsely low vitamin B12 levels in infections and certain conditions wherever they go up. So I take it with a pinch of salt. We have to therefore look at other parameters to whether they fit in or not. Hemophagocytosis. Now, hemophagocytosis is a very specific finding. And firstly, you have to differentiate it from M. peripilosis, which is just innocuous looking cells lying in a megakaryocyte and not really a vacuole around them. So first you ensure this is really a hemophagocytosis by looking at vacuoles and other changes around it. So if it is hemophagocytosis, now this patient has fever, also had dengue serology positive. Some kind of these patients have, so he seems to have low TLC, so is prone to infections. And these infections could therefore have resulted in hemophagocytosis that is there. Even if you see one hemophagocytosis, a definite one, you can't exclude it. You can't rule it out. You can't say that it is not significant. It is significant. The other thing that points to this could be the maturation arrest that has been seen in the marrow in the myeloid series. Why should that happen? So whenever there is an infection of some sort, you get a maturation arrest, especially in myeloid, what we say shift to the left with some prominence of granules may be there. So these are the pointers towards there may be an infection.
Sure.
Which may be responsible for hemophagocytosis that may be there.
In the aspirate and the biopsy itself, are there anything specific for inherited marrow failures? Because clearly this is a very small baby, and of course this could all be post-infectious at the moment, but is there anything which we will specifically look for?
So generally it is very difficult to differentiate whether it is inherited bone marrow failure or acquired on biopsy alone, unless you can see some other features of acquired, which I said that you see like a viral inclusions are there or thing. Otherwise you really cannot differentiate, and that's the reason we have to resort to stress cytogenetics to help differentiate between the two. You had another question over there about small children. Do we go ahead for biopsy? There are a lot of technical challenges, and yet I think sometimes we do need to do a bone marrow biopsy in an infant, and you can then go to the iliac crest and do it, because I think sternum is not a very technically it is very challenging to do it from the sternum. But you do have to do it.
For want of time, I skip over these and give you the progress of this child. So this child was lost to follow-up and came back at 9 months of age with a very short history of fever again. But what was important was that there was a persistent loose stool, and that the workup showed a persistent severe pancytopenia. And importantly, the stool fat was elevated. So this was failure to thrive, persisting pancytopenia in an infant who had chronic diarrhea and elevated stool fat. So we were thinking along the lines of, unfortunately, we were not able to do a stool elastase, and we didn't have access to stool trypsinogen or isoamidase. So we did go ahead and send this whole exome, which showed us compound heterozygous for two genes, one for Shaman diamond and one for this relatively new gene DNAJC, which has been associated with Shaman diamond. So if I could get the idea of putting this up was, now we will be having more access to whole exome sequencing. So could I get Dr. Revati ma'am and Dr. Tulika to help us out to say in which situations we should send these panels and what do we do with a variant of unknown significance?
So, I mean, in this case, there was no doubt at all that you needed it because the baby was less than 2 years at presentation, and we do need at this age to find out why they had. In fact, at the less than 2 years, they could also be associated with primary immune deficiency. Sometimes they have microcephaly. So these are the children that we definitely, any child with dysmorphism, any child with a family history of malignancy, liver problem, lung problems, and if they are less than 2 years, better to go ahead and get the whole exome sequencing and only to plan treatment based on these results. And nowadays, we can fast track and get it within 21 working days. So it would be better to make, if we have a suspicion that this could be inherited. And with the variants of the unsignificant, which are the ones which are significant and which are the ones which are not significant, best to discuss with the lab and say, this is what we are seeing clinically. Does it correlate? And if we have any issues, it's better to get both the parents tested to see if they are carriers, and that would complete the whole picture.
Yeah,
so I think what Dr. Revati said is absolutely correct. The only thing I want to add is that in something like what you're thinking is Schwarzman-Diamond, you can have mutations which can be homozygous or heterozygous, or you can even have no mutations. So if you have a high clinical significance, you need to make sure that even if the lab is not giving you any of this, that you don't ignore the clinical thing that you're thinking about. There is a new thing that is coming up called copy number variant. These are allele copy number variants. So you can have families where they don't have any mutations, their genes look everything okay, but just the allele copy number is abnormal. And in a study in Canada where they had about 300 families like this, where they thought they had inherited bone marrow failure syndrome, but they hadn't, but they were the non-classical ones. In 50% of them, there were no mutations. They only found these abnormal allele burden. So the thing is, the field is still evolving, and nothing is better than your clinical sense. So if you feel that something's there, it's very important. The only thing I want to just add is that this mutation that you're finding, the DNA JC21, it's also associated with myeloid malignancy. So definitely, I think a baby that you're going to have to watch. That's it. Thank you.
How would you, I know we have exceeded time, but how would you treat this child?
This one, whenever they are ready, this one definitely would offer upfront transplant. As Tulika said, if they have genes that have a high risk towards malignancies, then speak to them. In the meanwhile, we have to support them for the chronic diarrhea, improve their nutrition, prevent infections, so all of those things. But it's not like it's an emergency, but start counseling them early for transplant.
Sure. So I think we'll call it a day because we are post time. I would like to thank my faculty and hand over back to Sunil for any closing comments and any burning questions. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Anand, and all the experts. It was really interesting session, and I think we're all very patiently listening and learning and imbibing whatever was said. Anything any of the students want to ask? Any questions? I think we have taken most of them while we were discussing, so I don't think there's any more questions.
Okay. Thank you. Yeah. Thank you, Sunil. Thank you, Anand.
Thank you. Thank you very much. So thank you all for spending your evening with us. Thank you very much. See you again next Thursday.
Yeah, there are some questions which were sent across. So maybe Sunil can share that with the students.
Yeah.
Sure. Thank you so much.
Thank you.